May the intrinsic and all-pervading grace of pure inclusivity, of the traceless everywhereness, of the all-good, all-great, natural perfection that is as it is and rests as it is, as this moment, awaken us to the vision of oneness. The recent videos have been kind of heavy, so we want to lighten up a little bit here. A little bit. When we view the situation at the level of the personality, it gets very sticky. Too sticky, that is for sure. For those who are at the level of spirit, I wish. The problem for me is that it seems like these videos with pictures of great teachers and music, they just don't get it done. I just don't get it. I could do those forever, you know? I have done a lot of those in the past. I'm not necessarily posting on YouTube. I've done a tremendous amount of work. It just doesn't quite get it done for some reason. I wish there's a way that it could get it done to help us out. Because just to, you know, we need someone who's at the level, of spirit, of the vision of oneness. God, just to hang out with someone like that would just be worth its weight in gold. Because the personality level, good Lord, that's where all the garbage is. All the garbage is there. And it's useless to try to clean it up. I was looking at a website this evening, and it was like the 25 ugliest athletes of all time. I had a good chuckle. But what was really amazing was the comments left by people. And I don't know if I've ever heard more venomous, hateful comments than on that site of people attacking this. It seems that the beautiful people who want to love everyone and claim everybody's wonderful are the most hateful, venomous people. And what they're basically saying is, we're all good people at heart. Why do you judge the body? We're all wonderful people at heart, meaning we're all wonderful personalities at heart. If you come from the level of spirit, it's a totally different reaction. It's a chuckle, and it's sort of, it's a different kind of thing. When you come from the level of personality, everyone's totally insecure. So if they hear something saying, oh, that person's got a very memorably funny face, they just like freak out completely, turn into Nazis. You know, it's just unbelievable. So that's why I'm saying the cult of personality is a very dangerous cult. They want the writer fired. They want all the advertisers boycotted. They want, you know, just all these insane, vicious demands just because somebody to put up a chuckle for other people. And the comments were actually quite funny. If we can't laugh at ourselves, then we have a big problem. And it seems like there's an epidemic of people who are incapable of laughing at themselves. Why? Because they believe the personality is their self. That's why the body personality is their self, is their identity. And so they want to establish this blissful happiness at the level of personality. And they say everybody's got to clean everything up so nobody has a chuckle about anybody else. I find that ETs are especially sensitive about that. Very sensitive. Of course, ETs coming to this world, they look very somewhat different. Some various ones. Some look somewhat similar, the Nordics, for instance, and Pleiadians and others. But some don't look like us very much at all. The reptilians look kind of grotesque, and the greys look, of course, yeah, yuck. So they're super sensitive about people's reactions to them in that way. And this has like permeated the progressive culture, the personality cult people, the PCPers, you know, personality cult people, are just hyper sensitive. Don't let anybody have a chuckle, you know. We all like people who are able to laugh at themselves, poke fun at themselves, right? Because it relaxes us too, and saying, hey, I don't need to be so perfect either. The personality is a mess. Actually, personality is thoroughly rotten to the core. All personalities are thoroughly rotten to the core. So it doesn't hurt to have a chuckle. Don't forget to laugh at this ridiculous silliness that we have invented, called the human condition. And then, of course, we blamed God for it, you know, which is even funnier. Yeah. We don't want to take authorship of it. You say, no, we didn't have anything to do with this. It's God's fault. Yeah. Well, the serious note, our basic confession here is that I have a severe continuity problem. No question about it. If not for that, I would have been enlightened, you know, 40, 50 years ago for sure, easily. I never would have lost a state of this state of inclusivity. Inclusivity is different than saying everybody's a nice person. That's not what we're talking about. It's the realization that it's impossible for everything not to be included. It's impossible for exclusion to take place. Totally impossible. Inherently that way. So we say, I have a severe continuity problem. Otherwise, I would have seen this long time ago. Just easy. Easy. It would be easy this very moment if we didn't have a severe continuity problem. For anybody. It'd be easy for anybody. If they didn't have a severe continuity problem, anybody could get it very quickly. We'd all wake up like that. It would just happen just that quick. So the fact that we don't, for sure, means we have this drastically severe continuity problem. We have forgotten reality entirely. We don't have a clue. We're absolutely clueless. That's why the vision of oneness is so important. It clues us in. We get clued in. That's all it is. We just get clued in. This reminds me of something very important to me. It reminds me of this. It clues us back into reality and then solves the continuity problem because of that. So, really, this is the number one responsibility for everyone in the world, is to get to the vision of oneness. Now, how we get there is somewhat unique in everyone's experience, but essentially, we are working on the continuity problem. And a vision of oneness directly addresses the continuity problem and resolves it. So we do need to acknowledge we have this continuity problem, severe continuity problem, fear of an abrupt change of our experiencing to an experience that is completely different than what came before. Very simple. And we just say, well, I can't relate this to what came before. I can't relate this. But if we practice for the vision of oneness, then when the vision of oneness dawns upon us, they'll say, hey, this is like very similar to what I was practicing before, you know, that it's got the qualities, is very much like what I was expressing in my practicing. And so you can relate it to something that came before. That's called continuity. Continuity, relating it to what came before, able to relate it in some way. That's why we practice. So it's a no-brainer, really. It's a no-brainer. But the fear of the continuity issue is so severe, almost nobody does it. They say, no, it's safer to try to build the personality up, aggrandize the personality, and let's find happiness on the level of the personality, and let's forget all about what we've forgotten about. We say, it's so far forgotten, we'll never get it back, so let's just forget about it entirely. That's the ego thing. Let's let it go. Just let it go. Don't worry. You'll never be able to remember, so just let it go. It's some kind of ancient, archaic residue, you know, some kind of residue of some big bang or something, whatever, but it's gone. It's forget it. Past, never to return. So that's it. And people who go for that, they become the super rigid, spiritually rigid, in terms of trying to enforce the dictums of the personality upon everybody, saying that this is the rigid cage we're in. We're going to forget about whatever that was way back. We're not even going to talk about it. So what they're basically saying is nobody should work on the continuity problem. Let's all work on our smile and our teeth, quite frankly. I mean, nothing better than our teeth. Smile and braces and It's like smarter. Look at those nice teeth. Look at the nice teeth we have. Nothing wrong with good teeth. But that's the personality situation. So we do confess, the basic confession, I have a drastically severe, huge continuity problem. I can't remember what reality is like. I have forgotten, almost entirely forgotten, really. So that's an incredible problem, because I have to remember. See, we keep thinking we can default. The ego tells us we can default. The ego says, no, no problem, no problem. Just default on it. You don't have to remember. Wrong. wrong. We have to remember. We have no choice, no option about that whatsoever. Permanent forgetfulness is not an option, because it's not in the will of God that it be an option. And there is no will stronger than the will of God. There is no will that can contravene the will of God, overcome or overthrow or displace the will of God. Period. Even though we think that we've made one by projecting our will and then acting as if that projected will is a separate will and that we're under its spell and its authority, and it's stronger than our will, which means de facto that this will is stronger than God's will, because our will and God's will is one will, you see. So we think we've made God, a new God, through projection. We think we've made a new God through projection, and there, here again, any clarity whatsoever kicks up the fear of the continuity problem. So the path seems kind of slow, because you go two steps forward and one step back. Always two steps forward, one step back, and it's tough. It's very tough. But you just have to keep slogging through the snow. And really, I have all the gratitude towards those teachers who have told me, you got to keep slogging through the snow. Those are the great teachers who have said, look, you know, it's really tough. It's really tough, but you got no choice. You have to do it. That's it. The Holy Spirit pointed out to me, the only reason why you're not doing it, you're lazy. If you don't do it, you're lazy, period. That's it. So I had to say, wow, don't want to be lazy. Jesus said, got no choice, but you got to do the practices. You got to practice. You have to work at it as fast as possible. You have to, you know, push it as much as possible, continuously. Sri Anandamayi Ma, same thing. Practice was all important, all important. No room for slacking at all. No room for slacking. Always try and do better the next. Each day, try to do better than the day before. Don't ever skip. Try to make your spiritual practice seamless. Seamless, she said, seamless. And you got to work at it and work at it and work at it. And eventually, she said, you erode the resistance. The continuity fear erodes gradually, melts like an ice cube. Just gradually it melts away. And then at some point, the continuity fear has melted to the point where the vision of oneness will dawn upon you. Maybe you'll get a few glimpses of it first, and then it will come. That's what we're told. Sri Shankara also said, hey, you know, you've got to work at it with the utmost effort, and make a lifetime of it. Just think of it that way. Sri Ramana Maharshi says, you have to make great effort towards it. Great effort towards it. Okay? On and on and on. Buddha said the same thing. So these teachers tell us that this hard work will pay off. This tough work we do will pay off. The personality cult will never, ever, ever, ever pay off. Never, ever pay off. People, personalities would come to Sri Anandamayi all the time and say, hey, look, I want to do some great work for humanity. And they'd had all these great plans for helping the personality out, be happy, right? And she said, look, just start practicing five minutes a day, and then go to 10 minutes a day. And that's all she ever said, just start practice, doing spiritual practice. Okay? That's it. She said, there's enough. You know, it's just knowing perfectly well the complete dead end of all this personality endeavor. So that's all you're really ever going to get from a genuine teacher, is just practice. You got to keep working at it. That's it. I keep wondering, how come I haven't gotten something more than that? What's wrong with me? That's all they have to give. That's all they have to give. That's it. And just they can motivate us because we see the result, and result is there in front of us. We say, wow, maybe I should start working. But of course, what happens is you keep thinking, I can just get this contact high, that's good enough, or whatever. Just, I feel so great. That's why Jesus left. He said, why are you leaving? He says, it's better for you if I leave. It's better for you if I leave, so you listen to the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will get you working. Whereas others just kind of want to sit around and say, oh, Jesus, you're so wonderful. I feel so great around you. And Jesus said, no, you've got to get down to the nitty-gritty of your continuity problem, dealing with that. So it's better that I go. But it's the hardest thing in the world to even do 5 minutes of practice. It seems futile, right? but you got to increase it. You got to increase it to the point where it doesn't feel so futile. And so these videos are long here, so at least you're putting in the time and you're putting in the effort. It adds up, absolutely adds up, because you have to become a workaholic on the spiritual path. Everybody does, a workaholic. And the only ones that succeed are the workaholics, really. Those are the ones that succeed. So if you are this kind of personality that's a workaholic on the spiritual path, you're going to succeed, for sure. For sure. That is what's getting it done. So don't feel sorry for yourself. Feel happy for yourself. Feel like you're a hero to yourself, because you are. You're a real hero to yourself, because you are getting it done. Getting it done. It's not glamorous. It's not glamorous. That is for sure. Because the personality places no value on it. No value. The world places no value on it whatsoever. You might as well be in another universe as far as they're concerned. So we know the vision of oneness is there for us. I know it for a fact. It is closer, is the closest thing, closer than close. That's what Jesus said to us. It's nearer than, it's the nearest thing there is to us, right? The vision of oneness. It is right here now. It is right here now. It is the faceless, totally transparent presence. Right now, it is the totally faceless, transparent presence right now. And what we see, the vision one shows us, is everybody and everything abiding in that, permeated by it, that they know it too, they're in it too. I mean, they are one with it. They're included in it. Even though they're not aware, they're included in it. But we still see forms like that. We don't see it all as nothing but pure spaciousness at this point, which is fine. But all is included. And even that, you cannot really convey it, but we can practice for it. And the personality wants to have it conveyed to it. Like, just tell me, I can get it. The personality, sure, that just a short explanation is all it requires, because it's so smart and so capable that it's for sure, if it's true, I should be able to get it just in a matter of a couple minutes, and say, oh, okay, I get that, yeah, sure, I get it. Can you explain it to me? Oh, okay, sure, yeah, got it. How many times have we seen that? Constantly, got it. The faceless, the nameless, the faceless, nameless, non-defined, baseless, traceless, non-aligned, non-arranged, non-composed, authentic, wide open, pure spaciousness. The wide open, pure spaciousness, we're in it. We are in it. You may have had a glimpse of this and wondering how come you don't have it again. It's because it's so wonderful, you just don't know how to handle it in terms of relating it to other people, relating it to the personality. Well, how do we relate this to the personality is the question. You can't relate it to the personality. We aren't the personality, so that's okay. We aren't the personality. Personality doesn't have to get it. Personality is just a whole bunch of judgments and defense systems based on those judgments arising from perception, sensory perception, which arises from mental projection, which arises from the desire to be prime creator on our part. So the personality, there is no self there. There isn't anything there. It's basically a defense system. Personality is a defense system, which is defending from against the continuity fear. That's all it is. It's a jumble of defenses defending against the continuity problem. So if the vision of one is the person, we don't need the personality anymore. So how is it without the personality? Meaning, how is it without all those defenses? They're not needed. They're not needed because you say, I have the vision of oneness, which is the intermediate step. I'm not going to be catapulted back into reality. So, solved. And no more need for the personality. Funny, why was I, when I played golf, why was I hitting everything and landing right next to the flag? I probably don't have a need to miss anymore. You know, the personality needs to miss the mark. It needs to find an excuse to go out of bounds. Somehow my ball kept ending up in bounds. Where in the past it would go out of bounds, it kept ending up in bounds. I said, what's going on here? I was like, really? It was a head scratcher. A dramatic change. And it's because I don't need to miss the mark anymore. See, the personality needs to miss the mark. It needs to, because it doesn't want to hit the mark, because it's afraid it is not aware of the continuity problem and the vision of oneness. It thinks it's going to go directly back to reality. And so, of course, it will hit the ball out of bounds. Oops, just rolled out of bounds. Bad luck. Bad luck there. Another foot, it would have stayed in. That's the personality, isn't it? Exactly that. Huh. I hit it 95 and it went in the lake. If I hit it 96, it would have made it over. You know, or if I hit it 100, just a couple yards short, and it went in the lake. And here, your ball's right next to the flag. Wow, it's just a matter of just a couple yards, I would have been right there with you. That's exactly how it is. Personality has to miss the mark. The personality is missing the mark. That's what it is. It's a missing the mark. That's why it's called sin. When we say we're all sinful, it means we all have this personality complex, this defense system, but that's missing the mark. That's what it does. But the real sin or problem is actually not the personality, but the continuity problem, continuity fear. And that can only be resolved by the vision of oneness. And this is the testimony of the great saviors, the great sages, the great saints. The vision of oneness, you have to have that. That resolves it for us. So the real sin, the real problem is the continuity problem. That's why I say the only problem that I have is the continuity problem. I don't have a personality problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a defense system problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have this. I don't have a complex of defense dynamics problem. I don't have a personality problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the real problem. Not the personality, but the continuity problem. Personality is defending the continuity issue. It's defending against clarity because of the continuity fear. So instead of putting your focus on the personality, that's a losing proposition. Put it on the continuity problem. For sure, I'm saying this for sure, having struggled with this my whole life, don't try to fix the personality. There isn't any one there. There's no ghost in the machine. There is no one there. It's just a jumble of defenses. Each one being self-referential. It's called duality. Duality is a self-referential ping-ponging type of situation. That is one defense judging another defense, saying, that defense isn't good. This is the right defense. And the other one judges the other defense. This one's the right. And there's conflicts and all this stuff, thinking that if just some defense triumphs over the others, it will be the right defense. Trying to come up with the right defense against the continuity fear. And since we all have to remember reality, there isn't any way these defenses can ever work. There's no way the personality can ever work for us. It's impossible. Totally impossible. So there's no point in trying to fix it, because we will simply not need it once we have the vision of oneness. We won't need it anymore. It won't arise. It'll just, vanish out of lack of need for it. It's like we're blowing on a trumpet, da 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 da, and then we realize we don't need to blow on the trumpet. Okay, we stop blowing on the trumpet. What happens to the sound? There's no more trumpet sound, right? Because we don't need to. So when we don't need to, keep on, pushing all this defensive structures with our thoughts and reactions, we'll just stop. We won't be sounding all those notes, of the notes of the personality. Personality is like this musical instrument. We're sounding all these notes, clever, tricky defenses. Once we see the vision of oneness, we won't need to do that anymore. So we don't need to actually figure out much about the personality. We don't need to dig into the personality. We don't need to fix the personality at all. We need to practice a soft landing in the vision of oneness. And then once we land in the vision of oneness, no more personality arises for us. Don't need it. It was only a system of defensive strategies. That's all it was. So you can see why the great mystics and saints and gurus and sages, etc., always just, didn't engage at that level of personality so much, right? They just say, hey, just do your prayers, do your contemplation, do your spiritual practice, whatever it is, whatever your tradition is. Many different traditions, but it's all basically the same stuff as far as practicing, soft landing into the vision of oneness. Atheists can do it, agnostics can do it, religious people can do it, everybody can do it. Because the vision of oneness is already the case for everyone. It's already the case, so we just have to see it. And when you see it, it's not like a religious experience or a spiritual experience or anything like that. It's not like that. I don't say, oh, I got Buddha mind or something. No. It's basically, you say, this is what I really want to see. This is like that. That's my reaction was, this is what I've always really wanted to see. This is it. Didn't have to name it. I just knew this is what I really want to see. No question about it. Unmistakably so. So you don't have to have any particular conceptual religious structure in order to practice or work on it or whatever. It's just that the vision one is what I really want to see, and to get a soft landing into it, we need to align our valuing with it. You can use religious precepts, concepts to align your valuing if you want, or you don't have to if you don't want to. You don't have to if you don't want to. It's just, this is what you really want to see. So you're aligning, you're valuing, saying, so if you say, this is what I really want to see, and only this is what I really want to see. This is, only this is what I really want to see. Then you will see it. It doesn't matter what name your teachers are, or your gurus, or under what banner you march, or anything. It doesn't matter what clothes you're wearing, what your social status is. None of that matters. That's not present in what you're seeing. What you're seeing is just this. Yeah, I don't want to get caught up in trying to describe it. It's just that you see there is no possibility of exclusion from God. None. We're all home. Everyone's home already. We never left. No one ever left. And it's the seeing this mentally, spiritually, you see it, is, you know, just totally what you want to see. I think that's the best way to put it. Totally what you want to see. It's total reassurance. This is what you really have always wanted to see. That's it. You don't need to relate it to any spiritual figure or religious figure. And if you want to, you can too. But the fact is that it is beyond all such constructs. Nobody's ever left, no matter what their thoughts were, no matter what their imagination, no matter what their dreams were. Nothing's ever left God. Nothing can ever leave God. So we don't need to make any effort to prevent anyone from leaving, do we? We don't need to make any effort to get anyone back home. No one's ever left. Nobody can ever leave. So it takes this enormous burden off our minds. You see, it's not enough. We think we're saved, but our fear is like, well, maybe other people aren't saved, and we're going to lose them forever. They'll be lost to God and for us forever. Not true. Not true. Only the personality believes that. Personality believes all sorts of things to defend against the continuity problem. Endless. The personality churns out endless dogma. Endless. None of it's worth a cent. Only the vision of oneness has value. The personality has absolutely no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So it's very important that you realize only the vision of oneness has value. Nothing else has any value. So this is all you want to see. You can't see this and see something else, because that something else would have to be some sort of judgment, which is based on the belief in exclusion. And there are all sorts of personalities that the way they act, you think, oh, this person must be excluded. Yeah, they must be excluded. And then you realize, no, nobody can be excluded, no matter how ugly their face is or something. It doesn't make any difference as far. It doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. There's nothing wrong with chuckling about it at some level. makes no difference. Nothing makes any difference. See, it's beyond characteristics. So it doesn't matter one way or the other. The fact is nobody can leave. Nothing can leave. Everywhere it is. Cannot. So it's okay whether you laugh or don't laugh. Doesn't make it, because you can't leave. You can't leave. You're already home. You never left. But this is not a personality realization. Personality can't be enlightened. There's nothing there to be enlightened. It can only be dropped. You can only, not drop, but set aside, gently set down, because you don't need it anymore. Actually, set it down lovingly and gently, because it served you well as defending you against the continuity fear. But don't idolize it. It was only temporary, and ultimately, you know, totally unnecessary. It was just out of ignorance that we thought we needed a personality, a defense system. And when you come into this world, people say, hey, you need a personality, meaning you need a defense system. So nobody's going to like you if you don't have a good personality, a good defense system. So people spend a lot of time and effort trying to develop a good personality, a good defense system against, you know, against the vision of oneness, really. They don't know quite sure what it's against, but against, certainly against dropping projection, realizing our will cannot be bound by anything. Certainly it's defending against these key recognitions. So what I would say is the vision of oneness, the reason why I'm not seeing it right now is because I must want to see that plus maybe something else. So according to Jesus and of course in miracles, you have to, the vision of oneness has to be what only that is what you want to see. You can't want to see that in something else at this same time. It's not possible. Because when you see that, the people's personalities don't matter anymore. Doesn't matter at all. Doesn't really even register. You see people, you see everyone as spirit, not as a good personality or a bad personality. When they call Jesus good, they say, why you call me good? Don't call me good. Because they were relating to him as a personality. Don't call me good. No. It's everyone, everything. There's only eternal life. That's not good. You know, there's only eternal life, nothing else. If you want to see something else, you won't see eternal life. If you want to see non-eternal life, which is simply a defense system, you won't see eternal life. You see one or the other. Have to see one or the other. You can't see them both. Can't see both. Nothing can ever leave everywhereness. How is that possible? Nothing can ever leave everywhereness. I think the mosquitoes are already out this time. Already out. It's like summer. It's like summer here in California. Bay Area. It is summer. It's unbelievable. Might as well be, you know, in the heart of summer. But still, we have this choice. Either we see this, what's not there, which is non-eternal life, which is, it's not there at all, but we think we're seeing it, or we see eternal life and recognize what's actually there. In the form of the vision of oneness where all forms still remain. How can the forms remain is the question, you see, but well, they too have nowhere else to be, right? We're so used to forms as being non-eternal, you know, that we think of eternal life as some sort of permanent form or something. But it's really the formless, the faceless, the non-defined that is eternal life. Can't define it. So you might say all the definitions that arise within eternal life do not define eternal life. So there's all these definitions, these forms, which are like definitions, attempts saying eternal life can be defined as this. Or here's an example of non-eternal life. Now these definitions do not define it. The undefined. So we get this sort of inner glow of reassurance that all our efforts to define eternal life didn't succeed at all, cannot be defined. Because it's never something else. It's never something else. It's never somewhere else. Everywhere in everywhereness is never somewhere else-ness. So looking at this, I'm seeing that the dawn is right there. So we're on a very truly progressive path here. So none of these definitions, all of them are equally irrelevant. And this is the great subsidence, equal subsidence I call it, is we realize that everything is equally subsided into this equal total non-relevance in terms of definition. So we say, no one is any worse than you. Your effort at defining is certainly just as bad as everybody else's. We're all equally bad, all equally futile, all equally total non-issue. And this is where the love is reestablished, of total love of everyone, is this equal subsidence. All definitions equally are totally irrelevant. It's not so much a failure, it's just totally irrelevant. Let's put it this way, it's better. Totally irrelevant. No relevance whatsoever. And since it's totally irrelevant, it just fades away. Completely fades. And we simply abide in this subsidence of the effort to be irrelevant to, you might say it this way, our effort to be irrelevant to reality is irrelevant. Okay, that's even better. Our effort to be irrelevant to everywhereness is irrelevant. This is getting closer now. It's getting closer. So see, we are working into it. This is the kind of work that gets into it. Our effort to be irrelevant is irrelevant. Everything's effort to be irrelevant to reality is irrelevant. Got it, see? That confirmation from some spirit. Our effort to be the double thing, right? The doubling down. Our effort to be irrelevant is irrelevant. This is, I find, the most potent, effective form is this double emphasis thing. The blissfulness of bliss. Our efforts to be irrelevant are irrelevant. Our efforts to get lost are lost on reality. Our efforts to get lost are lost on reality. Our efforts to die are dead to reality. Our efforts to be irrelevant to reality are irrelevant to reality. Our efforts to be dead are dead to reality. Our efforts to be dead are dead to reality. So I would say, in whatever practice you're doing, use the double emphasis. This is what I found to be effective. It's like using a rotohammer to drill through something. It's way more effective. The drill can just get stuck and it gets glazed. The heat glazes and you're trying to drill through something and it just doesn't go any further. It just doesn't work. The rotohammer goes, you know, pounding, pound, pound, as it's drilling, pounding. And it keeps breaking, you know, that glazing kind of that's happening. The heat glazing and friction glazing, etc. And it just goes right through the wall. So it's that double emphasis, the double emphasis that actually works. And, you know, it's not something that I've heard about because people don't use it. Fear of the continuity issue, it's too successful. People freak out, say, whoa, whoa, wow, wow, this is getting too heavy for me, this is getting too close. But, you know, just aware that this works, and just be aware that it works and say, okay, this is where I live now. I live in effectiveness. I live in the land of effectiveness. My effort to be ineffective to reality is ineffective to reality. See, my effort to be ineffective is ineffective. My effort to be ineffective is ineffective. Let me see if I can do any of this. My effort at non-being is non-being to reality. It's not happening. My effort to not happen in reality is not happening in reality. is not happening. That effort to be irrelevant is irrelevant. My effort to not exist does not exist in reality, so to speak. My effort to be non-existent is non-existent to reality. My effort to be unreal is unreal to reality. At a certain angle, this works. The personality can twist it, of course. It can twist any practice. You have to recognize this. The personality can twist any practice to make it seem like it's interfering with some other truth that you said. It always will do this. You just have to ignore it. And keep practicing. My effort to be irrelevant to reality is irrelevant. See, we're using this double form intentionally. Okay. Intentionally. We're aware the personality complains about this because it's effective. That's why it's complaining. To say, stop this, it's too effective. You're going to, you know, you're going to see the vision of oneness. And personality says, if you do that, I'll have to leave. Well, of course, you won't be around. I won't need you anymore, is what will happen. The personality says, well, if I'm not around, I won't be able to protect you. Well, you don't need to protect us from the vision of oneness because it's smooth. You know, it's totally smooth. It's smoothed out smoothness. My effort to disappear from reality, from everywhereness, it has disappeared from everywhereness. But I would say that the best one so far is that the effort to be irrelevant to reality is irrelevant to reality. The effort to oppose reality is unopposed by reality. It's another way to turn it. You can say the effort to be all bad to reality is all good to reality. You can also practice that way too. So you can do different ways. It's all good. Each one has this double emphasis. The important thing is to practice the double emphasis because that is the vision of oneness. It feels like that way. Double emphasis gets really close to what it's like. And to the personality, it's a paradox or something. Personality can't relate to it. My efforts to fail are a fail to reality. My efforts to fail failed with reality. My efforts at failure are a failure. My efforts at failure are a failure to reality. My efforts to die are dead to reality. My efforts to die are totally dead to reality. My peace is identical to all peace. See, my peace is identical to all peace. My bliss is identical to all bliss. My calm is identical to all calm. My stillness, just as it is identical to all stillness. My centeredness, just as it is identical to all centeredness. My divinity, just as it is the authentic sameness of all divinity. My beauty, just as it is the one traceless, authentic, natural, unborn, same beauty as everyone. My freedom is the same freedom of everyone. My vision is the same vision of everyone. It's the exact same vision. My relief as it is exactly the same relief as everyone. My serenity just as it is exactly the same authentic, baseless, groundless, wide open, spaced out, transparent, serenity as everyone else's totally wide open serenity. My serenity is your serenity. My bliss is your bliss. My stillness is your stillness. My nowness is your nowness. My nowness is the exact same as your nowness. My presence is exactly the same as your presence. My timelessness is identical to your timelessness. Okay, my agelessness is identical to your agelessness. My eternal life is identical to your eternal life. Everything is identical. All qualities, identical qualities. My effortlessness is identical to your effortlessness, to everyone's effortlessness. My spaced out radiance is identical to your spaced out radiance, to everyone's spaced out radiance. My holiness is exactly identical to your holiness, to everyone's holiness. And the personality will say, hey, you don't need me for this stuff. what are you going to do? Keep me sharp. You got to keep me on my toes. You know, this stuff is putting me to sleep. You got to keep me sharp. No, we don't have to keep the personality sharp, this defensive structure. We don't have to keep it sharp. We don't have to keep working it out, too. Let it get fat and lazy. The one smoothness is my smoothness, is your smoothness, is everyone's smoothness. The one smoothness rests in the one smoothness. and say, purity, 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 one purity, one purity, one purity. Eventually people just use shorthand and say, it's just the oneness, it's the oneness. It's just like a shorthand, because all qualities are one. They're all identical to themselves. They're not dualistic. Saying, well, there's more over here and less over here. They're not engaged in this struggle with themselves. There's no struggle. The struggle-free, you know, the struggle-free spaciousness, the struggle-free spaciousness, the struggle-free pure spaciousness, the non-relative, non-localized pure spaciousness, the non-localized, okay? It is all non-localized. Every quality, the beauty, the forgiveness, the peace, the bliss, the nowness, timelessness, everlessness, all goodness, every last aspect, the simplicity, the being, the pure matrix, the awakeness, the miraculousness, the treasure of it all, the light, the divinity, the silence, the smoothness, on and on and on and on and on, all of that. Each quality, each way we want to qualify it that way, it's all that way. It's all non-localized. Every aspect of it, however you want to say, it's all non-localized. And since everything is self-evident, since it's totally non-localized, why do we need to define it? For what purpose? To locate it? Don't we use definitions for the purpose of location? Do we not? Huh? United States. Why do we say that? Well, so we know where it's located. I live in the United States. Oh, I know where you're located. I live in this city. I have this body. I know. Oh, I'm located right here. Okay, I'm located in this town. I live in this house. There's this plant right there. This type of plant. It locates location of something. And you can say, well, that look at that yellow house. Location of a yellow house. You know, the quality, the whatever of someplace. But all qualities of reality are non-localized. Seamlessly non-localized. So they're undefined in terms of location. See, definition really has to do with location. A lot to do with that, right? Quality too. You know, you say, oh, but these all qualities are non-qualified. Non-quantified, non-qualified, non-localized, non-referential, non-aligned, non-arranged. See, there's nothing to quantify. Non-quantified wide openness. Non-compounded, non-fabricated. Every quality is just that. The freedom is the freedom. Entirely, totally, non-localized freedom, right? It's not some freedom here and less over there. It's equally spaced out, equally smoothed out, equal vision. Total perfect overlay, as it were. Seamless, non-crystallized, non-conglomerated, non-congealed. So non-defined. So we say it's peace, we're not defining it. Not in the terms of the personality, in terms of definition. We're simply pointing to even pointing, you know, we're simply expressing in a term something, but it's really not a definition. It's the undefined peace. Let's just double up and do that. I'm experiencing the undefined peace. This is the undefinable bliss. This is the undefinable vision of oneness. Now, of course, the personality will object, as always. Don't worry about it. There won't be any need for a personality once we see this. So what do its objections matter? Not at all. Make no difference. It's just saying, trying to defend you, saying, hey, wait a minute, that sounds kind of scary. I mean, non-localized, that's kind of scary. Let's talk about it, you know, it pulls you out of it. Let's talk about it. It is the non-localized vision. It is the non-localized freedom. It is the undefinable vision. It is the undefinable peace. Jesus said it's the peace beyond understanding, which is a way of saying peace beyond definition. Personality can't understand it because it doesn't value it. Personality only values avoiding the vision of oneness. That's it. It's its only value it has. So, of course, it won't understand it because it doesn't value it. So you can try to explain it forever, and it will never understand because it can't value it. It's your own fear of the continuity issue saying, stay away from that stuff. It's you cannot value it, but we can value it. That's what spiritual practice is all about: is getting past this continuity issue, soft landing into valuing the vision of oneness. So. It is the locationless bliss, the undefined, traceless, baseless, groundless, locationless, formless bliss. It is the formless bliss, the formless peace, the formless presence, the formless radiance. What form can everywhere have? Where can it have this form? Is it meaningful to speak of forms in terms of everywhereness? Does it have any meaning? Not really, no. As a convention, we can use terms. That's fine as a convention. But does it really have any meaning? No. Where do we locate this everywhereness? You know, as a thought? Is it locatable as a thought? Thoughts are really just more locationalizing. Defining, self-referencing, dualism, all that. But is the totality, is that a definition, the totality? What need does the totality have for a definition? What need does it have? What need does endlessness have for a definition of endlessness? Does it need to be defined? Is there some need? Does it have some insecurity without a definition? We claim that it does, and we're helping it. We're helping define it. We think, oh, that poor everywhereness. It's so undefined. We're giving definition to it. This body here, there's a nice definition to it. Does it really need it? Does it really need it? That's a question, right? And what you discover in the vision one is it doesn't need it. It doesn't need it. It's not needy. Everywhereness doesn't need a boundary. Doesn't need a definition. Doesn't need a delineation. Non-delineated, non-defined, faceless. Doesn't need a face. Doesn't need a face. And so we're all free. We're all free from any need. That need to provide a face to reality, to write a face to the faceless. Reality doesn't have any such need, and the vision of oneness shows us that. There isn't any such need, and oh, it's over. It's lifted off of us. We're saved. We're saved from this horrible journey that we thought we needed to do this. We just laid this burden on ourselves. God didn't lay it on us. We laid it on ourselves to rationalize what we're doing. Nice explanation. Oh, we're just defining reality here. We're just here to give a form to the formless. Is it really, the formless is really some poor, orphan that's desperate for us to give it form. Is that really what it is? The personality sees it that way. But is that really the case? So it's not an abyss. We discover it's not an abyss. It's not an abyss of neediness. Reality is not an abyss of neediness. Just the opposite. No neediness. And the personality says, "Ah, well, then you don't need me then." Yeah, that's right. We don't need the personality anymore. Ah, you'll fall into an abyss. No, we won't. There's no need. No abyss of neediness. So we can still play adventure, sure, but not out of this sense of neediness or need to do it for the sake of everywhereness, the sake of defining everywhereness. It's simply undefined because it doesn't need to be defined. It's already defined as God. It already is what it is. It's not other than what it is. And since it's everywhere, why do we need to define it? It's right here. It's always right here, right now. So do we really need a definition for what's always right here, right now, is the question. Do we really need a definition for what is right here, always right here, always right now? Do we need to localize it? Why do we need to localize it? If it's always right here, always right now, always, why the need to localize it? Why do you need to put a handle on it? Is it gonna escape away from us? We need to grab it. Oh, there goes everywhere. Everywhere is it's leaving me now. So we need to lock it up somehow. Lock it up. Have a way to locate it. Put a GPS on. You know, tag it. Get the GPS. RF chip it. We need to RF chip everywhereness. So it doesn't leave us, so we can locate it when it leaves us. Where is everywhere that's gone? I'm searching for it. What are you searching for? I'm searching for everywhereness. Somehow it disappeared on me. I don't know where it's hiding. No, it's the symbols, the definitions that tend to hide and disappear when you realize you don't need them. So wait, where'd it go? Where did it disappear to? It didn't disappear, we just simply didn't need it. It was a waste of our time, waste of our attention. There's no reason to continue to project definitions. It's just like the sound of a trumpet. Where it disappeared to? It didn't disappear. It's just we're not playing it anymore. So it's not arising. It's just simply not arising. It's not a question of it arising and disappearing. When it doesn't arise, how can it disappear? To say that it's disappeared means that you're saying it's arising. It's still arising. It's not arising. There are no definitions that are arising from reality. So there's nothing to disappear. Reality cannot disappear anything. Reality cannot disappear anything. It cannot disappear anything, so. This is the vision of oneness. You see, you realize that reality can't disappear anything. Because nothing's arising other than other than what it is, other than reality, is nothing's really arising at all. No definitions are arising. There's, where can something arise to, from out of something to into something? Well, there's no real arising taking place at all. So how can anything disappear if nothing's arisen in the first place? Imagine if you realize that nothing can disappear. There's no such thing as disappearance. No such thing as loss, because there's nothing has arisen which can be lost. There isn't anywhere it can be lost. So how can something arise that can be lost? Nothing can be lost to the oneness. There's nothing lost to the oneness, because there's nothing arising other than the oneness. There's nothing other than it. Is there something other than everywhereness that's arising in everywhereness? No. It's only everywhereness. It's only right here, right now-ness. So it can't be lost. Everywhereness cannot be lost to itself. Where could it go to be lost? So nothing is lost. This also is realized. It's part of the vision of oneness. This is part of this relief. You know, it's different way. It's a way to express. It's this, nothing can ever be lost. Wow. The sense of relief is palpable. You know, the sense of relief, you can cut it with a knife. You know, it's just like so thick, the sense of relief. This is the presence around the great saints, mystics, sages, gurus, etc. It is this palpable relief. But people say, oh good, I know I can't be lost to you. I'm saying because I can't be lost to you. That's not the realization. Intrinsically, inherently, loss is impossible. That's different than saying, I can't be lost to you because I have a relationship with you and you won't leave me. No, loss is impossible. What can I be lost to? Can it be lost to everywhereness? Is there somewhere to hide in everywhereness? Is there somewhere outside of everywhereness? Is something arising is different than everywhereness? Is something arising not within pure spaciousness? Not occupying pure spaciousness? Is something not occupying pure spaciousness? What is that? No. Everything is occupying pure spaciousness. There's nowhere else to occupy. So how can anything be lost to pure spaciousness? Anything is it's occupying space, right? It's occupying spaciousness. How can it be lost to it? How can anything be lost to it? So you get this overall sense of everything there is can never be lost. Loss can't happen. Loss cannot happen. It can never happen. And so this comes as a tremendous relief. I can't lose myself no matter what I do or don't do. In spite of all of nature being seeming to be lost to itself continuously, loss can't happen. Because none of it ever is lost to pure spaciousness at any point. Never is there a break in this fact. Never is there a seam in this fact. It's a seamless fact. So, one way you could look at nature as not doing anything for anything. It's just this purposeless, you know, you can see it that way, that's possible. Because nothing's happening. Nothing's really happening at all. Nothing's being lost. This great effort to lose is doing nothing at all. It's not losing, nothing's being lost. And then the whole worry about process disappears too, because there is really no process, meaningful process taking place at all. All of nature, just as it is completely lossless, free. Right now, right here, right now. And the person, I said, wait a minute, you need something, you need to lose something, let's get back to the vision of loss. I said, no, personality. Nothing is lost. Nothing can be lost to everywhereness, pure spaciousness, zero dimensionality, perfect non-density. So all is this one lossless free state right now. Just as it is right now, everything, this planet, is in a perfectly lossless state. This universe as it is in a perfect lossless state. This everythingness as it is in a perfect lossless state. So then everything becomes non-relative, right? Non-localized, non-relative. Suddenly, it detaches from this meaning of loss, and you have this different perspective. This is the vision of oneness. There's a gentle, hardly really perceptible, just morph into detachment from this loss. It's no longer, nothing's attached anymore. It's perfect non-attachment. You might say, perfect non-attachment. So this is really heavy stuff. I'm feeling it just very powerfully. Doesn't hurt or anything, but you can feel there's a strain to it. There is this detachment, there is this release. This is what the teachers have talked about, where we're no longer demanding that nature be what we want it to be, a evidence of loss. So you've set everything free. Literally, we set the whole universe free from our demand that it be evidence of loss. So there's some great explosion, some great release, everything flees away. No, nothing happens. Everything continues to happen exactly as before. But now it's not happening anymore. There's just this total non-happening. A non-happening for no one. Nature is released from needing to be a happening for anyone. Is not a happening for anyone, not even for itself. It's a total non-happening. No loss is taking place. And this is the same. Nature for you, nature across the planet's all the same. Exactly the same. Well, this is good, though. I asked the Holy Spirit, should I do a taping? Yes, yes, yes. I say, I don't have any topic. Doesn't matter. You just try. Just try. And look at what's happening. This is very, very profound. Forget about the personality concerns that tries to intrude upon your practice. Just say, no value, forget about it, no value there. It's a gentle lifting of the demand. It's not so much like releasing a rubber band, it's just to gently release this demand. It just no longer needs to be seen that way. And we realize it's always been this way. It's always been this way. There's never been any loss. Not even a moment of loss. Not even one moment. So you might say there is no nature, actually. There isn't any nature. That was just our own projection. Just the one, just the one. So, yeah. So we can get close to this. We can get close to it, absolutely. I got very close to it, and now I'm just letting it, you know, say, okay, got close to it. I'm not gonna struggle with it. Don't ever get into this struggle where you're struggling for breath. Like, you know, no, don't get into that. If you feel like you're struggling, just sort of back off a little bit and just say, I have a severe continuity problem. I have a severe continuity problem. So, it's the only problem I have. Vision of oneness is only the vision of oneness has value. So, only the vision of oneness is what I really want to see. That's all that I really want to see. And just go back to this fundamental declaration instead of struggling with anything. Don't struggle. That's what really causes you a problem for your next practicing. You don't want to leave the practice in the state of struggle. No way. So if you feel like you've gone as far as you can, then you cool down and you say, I've got a very severe continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. I don't have a vision problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a oneness problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an understanding problem. I have a continuity problem. Only the vision of oneness has value. The understanding problem has no value to me whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value. The vision of oneness is all that I really want to see. The vision of oneness is only the vision of oneness is what I really want to see. Only the vision of oneness is what I really want to see. Okay, cool down with this. My will is free. Only the vision of oneness is what I really want to see. My will, as it is always eternally free. The power of decision rests within me. Okay? The power of decision rests within me. And you go back to this. when we finish up this effort, you go back with to this cool down period. The vision of oneness is only the vision of oneness is what I really want to see. My will as it is, my will is always unboundedly free. The power decision always rests within me. The power decision always rests within me. All right. Very great. That's it for this one. Yeah. Very powerful resonance from this one. Stay in the mood of repentance. Stay in the mood of repentance. Say, I have a severe continuity problem. I'm not going to demand success. You know, this instant, I have a severe continuity problem. I'm working on it. I'm working on it. I'm working on it. Very great. That's it.